I was a freelance writer who got tired of writing scripts about nothing at all, and I began reading science fiction. And among the science fiction I read was the Swifts about the Lilliputians. And I began to see from that you could write about something in science fiction. And so I dreamed up the Star Trek idea so that I could comment on man and society. They didn't want to have anything to do with it. They thought that I made it too complicated. They felt I had offered them a wagon train to the stars, which I had, because I wanted to sell it. And Westerns were very big at the time. And I felt that I'd double-crossed them. I'd written them this thing about where the mind went in certain ways, and they wanted someone with bare knuckles in a fist fight. They turned it down, but they did like some parts of it. The first time they said they'd ever felt like they were truly in a spaceship. And they turned it down. They said, now, if you will really give us the equivalent of a Western, we can put you back to work on it. So we made him a second show, which had a lot of science fiction elements too, but at least it ended up with Bill Shatner in a bare-knuckle fist fight, in which he beats a godlike figure in a fair brawl. And I thought it was a terrible idea, but it worked and it met their needs, and that started us. We sold Star Trek with it. Jeffrey was a good actor, and it was good to have him on the show. However, his wife kind of felt that science fiction was a little beneath him. And so they didn't want to go on to a second pilot. Bill Shatner then came available. Thank God, because Bill did a marvelous job, as we know from 20 years of reruns. And with it behind him, we put the series together. It was both. It was sort of a little fakery on my part, too, because Westerns were exciting then, and they could understand wagon train, whereas very few people in those days read science fiction. And almost no network executives or studio heads. And, they thought in terms of Buck Rogers and of naked girls in silver breastplates and nothing about what the heart of real science fiction is, stories about people and ideas. And so I had to fake a little bit to get them to watch it. Well, I had enough up and down, so when I came back to Paramount and we started talking about a second run of Star Trek, which became The Next Generation, I said I wasn't interested. I just, in all of those years of doing 78 Star Trek episodes, the emotional cost was too much. I was being censored because they claimed we had open mouth kisses, and they were measuring. We had a whole show thrown off the air because a lady's navel was seen in it. And although the next year, the networks came out with Laugh-In, and belly buttons were wild then. It's a ridiculous way for a writer to lead his life, to have junior executives who don't know writing and don't know science fiction telling you you cannot do this or you must do this. I'm an artist, basically. That's what artists have done since time immemorial. That's why you've always had artists, even with cavemen and so on. It is a basic and necessary function for humanities. Artists explain everything that we see and explain why it's important. And art is not a thing of deft, beautiful writings or sculpturing of music. It's a thing of comment. I had always been a fan, speaking of Westerns, of Gunsmoke, and with their cast of Kitty and Doc and Chester and so on. And I noticed how well that worked over episode after episode. And I thought, if I ever do a series, I want to do the same type of thing where the characters are like Uncle Joe drops by, and there's Dad, and there's Brave Brother, and so on. And so I really cast my Star Trek people as a television family. And you knew what their secrets were and you would laugh at the same joke every week, as you do in real life. Captain Kirk is Captain Hornblower of the sailing ships, who was a great hero, and Hemingway said is the most exciting adventure fiction in the human language. Myself, I had screwed up so many times in life through emotions, I thought, wouldn't it be fun to write someone who is totally emotionless and logical? Chekhov came on the show because I'd read something and someone had sent me a copy of a Russian newspaper in which they said after our first year, oh, the ugly Americans are at it again. We were the first people in space, but the Americans don't even have a Russian aboard this crew. So I wrote the Russian aboard the crew and sent a copy of it to the Communist Youth newspaper, which they never answered. When I was trying to find a name for Nichelle Nichols, and thought of the Swahili for freedom, which is Uhuru, and decided to make it Uhura. I knew I could hear her shriek of joy from across town. I was pleased that in those days, when you couldn't get even blacks on television, that I not only had a black, but a black woman and a black officer. And that'll show them. Great affection I have for Asians and what they do and the important part they play in the world, and I just could not have a group of Earth people without including that great, you know, one half or more of the Earth continents. Scots have always been shipbuilders and ship engineers and so on, and that was a bow to true tradition, and a great fun bow too. Because it speaks to some basic human needs that there is a tomorrow. It's not all going to be over with a big flash and a bomb. That the human race is improving. We have things to be proud of as humans. No, ancient astronauts did not build the pyramids. Human beings built them because they're clever and they work hard. And Star Trek is about those things. I feel that my principal love is writing, words, language. Probably if I had started directing early, I would have enjoyed it very much, because certainly the director, particularly in motion pictures, is the man in charge of a production, which is sort of the reason I decided to, after producing the first Star Trek movie, I decided to go back to television, because in television, the writer-producer is the man. And I was more interested in getting my ideas over than I was in making a movie that looked good. Well, I'm very close to the people at NASA and places like that, as at MIC and MIT and so on. And I learn a lot from them, and they call me with ideas. As a matter of fact, one of the advanced planners of NASA is arriving in town today, and I'll be having some meetings with him next week. They've been very helpful. I was very afraid when I started Star Trek that scientists and NASA people would say, oh God, you're so inaccurate and you're so wrong. I almost hated to deal with them at first until I discovered that they're not like that. They're intelligent, and because they're intelligent, they understand the problems of show business. And they understand that I had to appeal to a mass audience as well as a specialized audience. And it's been a love feast. Someone asked me some years ago, before I'd ever gotten any kind of a check for Star Trek reruns, what is your profit on the series? And I said, the greatest profit of all, the people that I could not pay to meet and know, Isaac Asimov and Arthur C. Clarke, and the NASA people, and the MIT Artificial Intelligence Lab, where I'm welcome. Wow, you can't buy that. Far too many people believed, and many still believe, that they're a bunch of teenagers who wear odd clothing and give odd signs and things, but they're not. Trekkers include businessmen, bank presidents, stockbrokers, college professors, and a large number of astronauts, of whom I saw a couple two nights ago who were out here. Trekkers are really, it also includes the kids, and God bless them and let them have fun. But it's people who sort of believe in the general type of thing we're talking about in Star Trek, that the human species is to be admired, and it is really going to go somewhere. Well, the fans were wild for the idea, and I kind of liked the idea, too. I was broke. People were not exactly standing in line to hire the guy. I was a much sought-after freelance writer until I did Star Trek. Then the story got around town that I had done this crazy series that practically broke the studio from its costs and all that sort of thing, and I couldn't get much work. I figured from the movie, maybe I could get involved to the point of making some money, which my wife and I desperately needed to pay our mortgage and so on. And so I guess I was encouraged by greed as much as by a chance to see what Star Trek could do on the big screen and with an adequate budget and so on. And I'm glad we went along that way. And when I didn't want to produce him, Harve Bennett came along, and he did a very good job. He was a very experienced producer, and I was delighted to leave that in his hands, with myself remaining, keeping the consulting function. First Star Trek series, we treated such things as mixed races aboard the spaceship, and whether women could be in charge of anything and so on. And when we shocked the audience, by saying yes to those questions. In the new series, with new characters and new attitudes, we have a chance to deal with still more important questions, and questions of the 80s and the 90s, such as the question of terrorists. The question of last year we touched on the question of drugs. Why do people take drugs? Because they're bad? Obviously, there's more to it than that. I want to touch on the problems of superstitions which rule the world and set people bombing each other. I respect them. There are all sorts of trekkers, from teenagers to businessmen to professionals. And they're people who want largely they want the same sort of things out of humanity that I want. It's strange to go to a meeting of people who are, some of whom are wearing strange clothes and making strange signs and so on, and find out that they're very serious and they care deeply about who and what this creature human is. Well, they kept it alive through their clubs and their various meetings and so on, and for which but they kept it alive because they enjoyed doing these things. They enjoy their conventions just as much as veterans enjoy their conventions. I've never let Trekkers, though, run Star Trek, because Star Trek is an artistic endeavor that is best run by the professionals then. I will listen to Trekkers and Trekkies. I will listen to the guard at the gate. And get many good ideas those ways. But I will never make a change in Star Trek because I think it will please the Trekkers. In that way lies prostitution. And you cannot be a good producer, writer, or anything if you first thing you ask is, what do they want? That's what prostitutes do. I write what I think they should have and what I think they'll enjoy. And thank God, I've been right occasionally. Because it says it's not all over, it's not all, we're not going to go up in smoke, we're going to make it. Because it says the human adventure has just begun. That's it in a nutshell. I would hope there are bright young people growing up all the time who will bring to it levels and areas that were beyond me. I don't feel jealous about that at all. I think that, as I was saying, Hollywood and the motion picture industry is a remarkable thing. And it'll go on without any of us and get better and better and better, because that really is the human condition, is to improve and improve. Get lost, you know. to go through the things I went through with network executives and so on, to do it all over again. On the first show, on the original Star Trek, I practically lost my family from working so many 12-hour days, 14-hour days, 7 days a week. And I said, you can't pay me enough to do that. But then they said, hey, but suppose we did it in a way in which they call syndication, in which we don't have a network, and we don't have all those people. And Paramount was saying to me, and we guarantee to you that you will be in charge of the show. I asked, who would be the censor? They said, you. You've been around television long enough to know what doesn't play and what can't. And very slowly I began to be... Oh, and then it occurred to me that we couldn't possibly do it with the old cast. The old cast was doing movies. You couldn't afford them in the first place. Nor could you do it with the old cast because the crew people you have who need encouragement, who need to have their thing. People don't just work for money. The mixers, the cameramen, and all of those people have to have their show. And with a new cast, it could be that way. It could be have new ideas and so on. The whole group could say, as they say today, it's our Star Trek. And you desperately need that. After doing all of those episodes, are there new things you can do? My God, yes. The basis of our series is the galaxy, and there's quite a few stories out there. I decided that we can't have people smoking. Although I smoked in those days, the networks advertised cigarettes. I said, man, we'll just be too smart to keep this up. So I said, no one smokes, which caused lots of problems. I feel the same thing about drinking today, and I hasten to say I drink and enjoy it. We're too smart to continue that for long, and we have invented for the barroom something called synthanol, which acts just the same as alcohol, makes you feel that you can be a lover or wise or all the things that alcohol does, but it's only temporary. You with a force of will, you can shove it aside and you're as sober as you ever were. So our ship will have synthanol. No, it makes me nervous because it isn't good enough what we did, and we've got to now build on that and make it better. Once you begin sticking your tongue out, literally or figuratively, at people, your brain goes too. And you end up with a show that is crap. And I want Star Trek to be do the things it can do. I've never felt that I had it made. What we can expect in the future is to continue to explore the human creature and what our problems is, and the things I talked about, the place superstition is playing in destroying harmony between nations and so on. Also, I'd like to get into a little bit into the absurdities of 20th century politics, which we can look back on from the 24th century. We'll consider the 20th century something that we had to go through, but our people will see it as something they're glad to be rid of, you know. Paramount said, we will back you in this, and by God, they did. And I've had nothing but good treatment out of them. I do feel sometimes they were nervous about giving the keys to the asylum to a writer, but despite their nervousness, they stood true to their word, and I really respect them and thank them. There's a guy who knows something about what Star Trek should be, but doesn't know it all. And I see Star Trek as part of the continuing education of Gene Roddenberry. I learn new things every day about science and humanity and history. They're paying me to go to college and paying me very richly, and I thank them.